Alrighty, guys, we are moving along in our CLT math practice on practice test number one. We left off at 98, so the next one, question number 99. For angle theta in the standard position, given that tangent of theta is positive and cosine of theta is negative, in which quadrant does theta lie? So, in which quadrant is telling us to think about a coordinate plane where you've got quadrant one, two, three, and four? And to answer this question really quickly, you need to kind of have this little chart memorized here. In quadrant one, since x and y are both positive, all sine, cosine, and tangents will be positive. Then you move over to quadrant two, only sine is going to be positive because that's your y over your hypotenuse. Then quadrant four, I'm skipping quadrant three and going to quadrant four. Only cosine will be positive because that's your x over your hypotenuse. And in quadrant three, your x's and your y's are negative. So your tangent is going to be positive because that's where you have your sine over your cosine, which would both be negative, and the negatives would cancel out. So you have tangent positive and cosine negative in quadrant three. Number 100, the average of the elements in a set of consecutive integers is 13.5. The average is 13.5. The largest is 15, and our question asks, what is the smallest? So, smallest to largest, and we know our average would be in the middle. And average is 13. 0.5, largest is 15. They want to know what's the smallest. And just consecutive integers just means numbers in a row. To go from 13.5 to 15, you're moving up. 13.5 to 14.5, you went up one and then up another half. So our smallest would have to be, out of these answer choices, would have to be 12, because 12 plus 1.5 would give us that 13.5. And then moving forward, number 101, the volume of a cube with a surface area of 24 square inches. What is the volume of a cube with a surface area of 24 square inches? So, volume of a cube. Volume equals length times width times height. And in a cube, your length and width and height will all be equal. Length, width, height will all be equal. So if the surface area is 24 square inches, then the area of one face of the cube we would take that 24 and divide it by how many faces are on a cube. You got top, bottom, side, side, front, back. You got six faces, like a dice, right? There's six sides on a dice. So the area of one face would be 4 square inches. And area means length times width, which and the faces of a cube are all a square, so length and width are equal. So the square root of 4 would be 2. So length and width are 2, which means also height is 2. So our volume would just be 2 times 2 times 2, which would be 8 cubic inches. And the last question I'm going to look at on this video is number 102. This is kind of a little bit more of a higher level trigonometry question than what we've been doing in class. So if that's not really your cup of tea, then you might want to go ahead and tap out here on this video. If you're interested in how to solve question number 102, I'll do my best to explain that now. Which of the following is not equivalent to the cosecant of 5 pi over 2? So, cosecant of 5 pi over 2. I know from my reference sheet that there's 2 pi radians in a circle. So, this 5 pi over 2, like that fraction, 5 over 2, it's like having 4 over 2 and 1 over 2 when we split that up, right? And that 4 divided by 2 is 2. So like we can kind of take out a 2 because this 5 pi over 2 is like a circle that goes all the way around, and then it continues to go some more here. So we just need this section. We don't have to find, the whole thing. So I would take this 5 pi over 2 and just change it to pi over 2, 1 pi over 2, which is just pi over 2. And when we're thinking about our circle, pi over 2, there's 2 pi radians in the whole circle. So if we took our circle and broke it into even quadrants, sorry, mine's not quite even. We broke it into even quadrants, right? We'd have a half and a half, a half pi, and a half pi. Those four halves gives us our 2 pi. So that pi over 2 over here is like 360 degrees in a circle is a fourth of that. It's like 90 degrees. So it's like cosecant of 90 degrees, which is how I prefer to look at this. You may have a different preference, but for me, this is my jam. So next, I would take my little rules that I have for sine, cosine, and tangent of our special degrees triangles. We have rules for 0, 30, 45, 60, and 90 degree angles for sine, cosine, and tangent, in which cosecant is equal to 1 over the sine of 90 degrees, or 1 over the sine of pi over 2. Now, these special rules over here, I'm going to draw a right hand, like I'm looking at my right hand. So here's my little thumb, my middle finger, and there's my pinky. Oof. Well, that might be the worst hand I've ever drawn. Anyways, when I'm using my little right hand trick, I got 0, 30, 60, no, 0, 30, 45 is in the middle, then 60, and then my 90 degrees is here. So using this, I know that my sine of 90 degrees is how many, the square root of how many numbers to the right divided by two. So that'd be the square root of at 90 degrees, one, two, three, four numbers to the right. So that equals one over the square root of four divided by two. And the square root of four is just two divided by two. So it's one over one. It's just one. And now also my cotangent of pi over here. I don't really want to look at A and B yet. I want to come right here to C. My cotangent of pi is going to be equal to cosine of pi over the sine of pi, which the cosine of pi is negative one and the sine of pi is zero. So cotangent of pi is negative one over zero, which is undefined. It's not equal to one. So this C is not equivalent to the cosecant of 5 pi over 2. And if I were to go through and do the math for A and B, though both of those would be equal to 1. I hope that this was helpful for you. And I'll see you on the next video.